So maybe sir, you can share your slides. Yeah.
Now the meeting has started. A recording is on. So you can introduce him while he shares his slides.
Yeah. I will just move some full screen mode. I will. Okay.
But your slides are not in the foreground. So are you doing the full screen to the slides or to some other window?
No, it's not
now.
Screen.
Yeah. Now it's fine. Now our Apple Hello. Thank you. Yeah, that's good.
But not moving. Oh.
This is fine. So yeah.
It's not moving.
Oh, can you click on it and then first? Yeah, it's moving.
Oh, there is some. Yeah, there is some time lag. Okay.
Okay, Ramesh, you can.
So welcome everyone to Harmonization Seminar. So today our speaker is Professor Sundaram Thangavelu. So today he will talk about an analog of Bartholin's theorem for the Heisenberg group. Sir, over to you.
Yeah, I have to thank myself because I volunteered to give this talk because I already prepared these slides for some other talks and the slide was empty. The slot was empty. And I didn't feel like letting it go. So I'm going to talk about an analog of Bartholin's theorem for the Heisenberg. That's the title. So let me start with Bartholin's theorem for the Euclidean Fourier transform. I will give a proof. So the Euclidean for the Fourier transform on Rn, the Bartholin's theorem states that there is no non-trivial function which satisfies which is for which this integral is fine, double integral is finite. That is integral of f times integral of the Fourier transform is integrable with respect to this measure exponential mod y dot psi dy d psi. So this theorem is attributed to Bartholin, but then he didn't publish it. Hermander published it in 1991, based on his notes. Bartholin presented this theorem to Hermander sometime long time ago, and then Hermander had his notes, and then Hermander reproduced his proof. Probably not Bartholin's proof, because Hermander's proof is sort of very brief. So that was the n equal to 1 case. And then later, this was generalized to the n-dimensional case by Bonomi, Demange, and Shama, and also a little bit generalized. And then recently means 2012, there was a new proof given by Head and Mom. This proof is so elementary, so one can present it in a seminar talk. So let's consider this strip in the complex plane. Modulus imaginary part of zeta is less than 1. So this is the open strip. And then consider this integral, double integral. This is f bar of y, f hat of psi, exponential I zeta, y dot psi dy d psi. Just consider this as a function of the complex variable zeta. Then you see that under the Bartholin's condition, so this I will call the Bartholin's condition. This double integral is finite. Under this Bartholin condition, it is clear that this integral converges absolutely and uniformly, and then it's the homomorphic function. Open strip. It's also continuous up to the boundary and it's bounded there. So that's all you have to observe. And when zeta is real, and then if I look at this, when zeta is R, which is real, then just integrate with respect to psi variable first, use the inversion formula for the Fourier transform, then what you get is f bar of y, and then this will be f of ry. So f of r is integral of this integral, f of ry, that's coming from the inversion formula. Then we have f bar of y. And then you make a change of variable and then rewrite it. Then you'll get r power minus n f of r inverse bar. So when restricted to the real axis, the holomorphic function satisfies this functional equation. So this allows us to extend this as a holomorphic function to the whole complex plane. So all you have to do is just look at g of zeta equal to 1 plus zeta squared per n by 2 f of zeta. So this is already holomorphic in a neighborhood of mod zeta less than or equal to 1, because this is holomorphic actually over the strip. So it is certainly in a neighborhood of mod zeta less than or equal to 1, except for the points I and minus I. This is holomorphic. And then because of this functional relation, I can define another the functional relation is translates is getting translated into this identity g of r equal to g of r inverse bar when r is real. Once we have this, this suggests that I define another holomorphic function by this relation g1 of zeta equal to g of 1 over zeta bar this will get another holomorphic function, but that will be holomorphic in mod zeta bigger than 1. So now we have two holomorphic functions, one in a neighborhood of mod zeta less than or equal to 1, another for mod zeta bigger than 1, but these two regions have a overlap along the real axis and over which they coincide because of this functional relation. So that means this can be holomorphically extend to the whole complex plane when there was some trouble at I and minus I, but these are removable singularities because the original function f is, because of the Bohrlenz condition, the original function is bounded near these two points. So it is an entire function. So we have an entire function and which happens to be bounded. Something is not visible. So g is thus a bounded entire function, so it has to be a constant. But then if you look at the functional equation satisfied by f, so f of r is r in r power minus n, f of 1 over r, etc., then as r goes to infinity, this goes to 0. That means the function g has to vanish at infinity, but then that means the constant is 0. So we have this f is 0 identically. But what is f of 1? Just so this is the definition of f of zeta with the zeta here. But take zeta equal to 1, you get this f bar of y, f at xi, e power I, x dot xi, dy, dx. And this is use the inversion formula again, then it is the L2 norm of f. So f of 1 equal to 0 is simply the L2 norm of f is 0, so f has to be 0. And that's what we wanted to prove. So Bohrlenz theorem is proved for the Euclidean case. So if I look at the proof, so what we have used is that just define this W naught of f hat comma y, it's just a weight function, call it a weight function. So integrating mod f hat xi against this exponential mod y dot xi. And then what we have is this relation. F is integrable with respect to this weight function. And this weight function satisfies this estimate. I mean, this weight function dominates f of x plus I y. Assuming that f can be holomorphically extended to some strip, then mod f of x plus I y is dominated by this weight function. And this weight function, with respect to this weight function, this f belongs to L1. So that's all we need. So we can replace this W naught by anything else. I mean, any other weight function satisfying these two conditions, then the Bohrlenz theorem is true. I mean, then we can get the same conclusion. So that means, but then for the little bit generalized case, you assume that f is already holomorphic. So originally Bohrlenz condition is given in terms of the double integral, but once you assume that automatically.
Sir, what you are assuming on the weight function?
Yeah.
And there you are.
I'm going to the next line, I would say that. So under the Bohrlenz condition, then f is already holomorphic, but then if you assume that f is holomorphic, this is the condition. Assume that f is holomorphic, and then modulus f of x plus iy over, take this hoop over x in Rn, so that has to be bounded by this new function. So let's say w of f hat, suppose take anything here that dominates x plus iy. F has to be zero. So only extra assumption I have to assume is that this has to be an increasing function of mod y. So if you look at the proof, that's all we need. So in particular, I can take in place of W naught. So W naught was F hat of psi and then exponential mod U dot psi. This is y. No, this is u. So instead of that, we can take this weight function. So this weight function has satisfied these two conditions. And also this is an increasing function of mod y. That's why I took the supremum here. That's all we need. Assume these two conditions where w is an increasing function of mod y. Then the condition two, the modified Bohrlenz condition implies that f is zero. So we can restate the theorem in this form. There is no non-trivial function f on R for which this is finite. That's it. So our aim is to formulate an analog of this theorem for the Fourier transform of the Heisenberg group. So Heisenberg group is Rn cross Rn cross R with the group law given by this x u t y v s is x plus y u plus v t plus s plus half. This is a symplectic form here. You don't worry about all those things. So in order to define the Fourier transform, I have to recall a family of infinite dimensional representations of the Heisenberg group. All of them are going to be realized on L2 of Rn, and I call them pi lambda, and this is Schrodinger picture. So pi lambda xut, that will be acting on phi, evaluated at xi will be e power I lambda t times e power I lambda, something here, x dot psi plus half x dot u, and this is a translation of phi by u. Then one knows that these are all irreducible, unitary, and then every irreducible unitary representation, which is non-trivial at the center, is unitarily equivalent to this, and all those things. And then the Fourier transform is an operator-valued function. You take function f in L1, and then just integrate f against these representations. On the Heisenberg group, the Lebesgue measure seems to be, Lebesgue measure happens to be the Haar measure, so you simply integrate, you get an operator value function. So this is the Fourier transform. F at lambda is operator value, unlike the Euclidean case where it is a function. Now it's a function of lambda, but it's operator value. So then we have a Planck-Schrodinger theorem. So when I take f in L1 intersection L2, f at lambda is not only a boundary linear operator, but it's Hilbert-Schmidt. So we can take the Hilbert-Schmidt operator norm squared, and then integrate it out against this measure, 2 pi power minus n minus 1, mod lambda power n d lambda, then you get back your L2 norm. So this is the analog of Planck-Schrodinger theorem for the Fourier transform on Rn. So we have these two things. One more thing. So we have this inversion formula. So in order to, this is inversion formula. Inversion formula I'm writing in terms of pi lambda x comma u. So this is by definition pi lambda x comma u comma 0. So this is t variable, it is just, this comes out actually for I lambda t. So I don't have to worry about that. So the inversion formula takes this form. Take the Fourier transform, it's an operator, multiply by pi lambda x comma u, it's a unitary operator, take its adjoint. Then this has to be trace class, take the trace, and then they take the inverse Fourier transform in the lambda variable. Then you get the original function here. So this is inversion formula. So from the definition, again, this is the remark I made here. Pi lambda looks like e power I lambda t times pi lambda x comma u. And then by taking the Fourier transform of the original function in the last variable, I will call it f lambda. I'm doing all these things because I need these notations in the formulation of the theorem. So take the Fourier transform, I mean inverse Fourier transform in the last variable, that is a single variable in R, that is Euclidean. Then call it f lambda x comma u. After that, integrate f lambda x comma u with respect to this pi lambda x comma u, this family of unitary operators. That t is nothing but f hat of lambda. So with this notation, I can define the so-called Weyl transform. Just integrate any function on Cn against this unitary family of unitary operators, getting a family of boundary linear operators. And then there is a Planck-Schrodinger theorem. There is actually Planck-Schrodinger theorem and inversion formula for the Fourier transform on the Heisenberg group is proved first by proving such results for this Weyl transform. So this is the crux of the matter is proving those things for this Weyl transform. So here it looks there is no integral with respect to lambda. So g of xu, you can just simply get it by taking the trace of pi lambda g times pi lambda x comma u star, and then just multiply by the small lambda power n, you get g. So now I'm going to define, let me try to imitate the proof of Edenbaum, the Bolling's theorem. So Bolling's theorem, what did we do? Then we had this function f bar of y, and then we had this another function f of, I put this zeta y and then dy, right? That was, that was the second step. The originally it was the e power I zeta y dot psi was there, but then once I have the inversion formula applied, then this is the integral turned out to be. So now I'm directly defining this one, f lambda of zeta, this f lambda y comma v bar, this f lambda zeta y zeta v divide dv zeta in C complex. This will be well defined only if I already know that this f lambda is a holomorphic function, because this is complex. F lambda y comma v, where y and v coming from Rn, is well defined, but then I'm using it zeta y zeta v. So I have to assume some conditions on f or f at lambda. In this case, I'm going to put some conditions on f at lambda that will guarantee that this Euclidean Fourier transform in the last variable fix lambda, and whatever I'm having is a function on R to n that should holomorphically extend to C to n. So I need some condition. So in order to do that, let me take the action of unitary group un acting on R to n. So unitary group is an n by n matrix, but then I can identify it with a 2n by 2n matrix in certain way. That way I can think of that as an element of SPNR intersection O to NR. So don't worry about this. So this is a 2n by 2n matrix coming from sigma. So sigma will act on x comma u, considered as a 2n by 2n matrix. And then this has a natural action. This action has a natural extension to Cn cross Cm. I can take in place of x, I can take z, and in place of u, I can take w. So it's a natural action. I will denote it by sigma acting on z comma w. So with that, the condition I want to impose on the Fourier transform that will sort of guarantee that this function f lambda is a holomorphic function on C to n, what I need is this one. Take the f at lambda. I know that it is a unit, so Hilbert-Schmidt operator, if I assume that f is L2. So if I look at pi lambda of x comma u, or pi lambda of sigma acting on x comma u, all those guys will be unitary. So it's a Hilbert-Schmidt and it's a unitary, it will be still unitary. But I want to consider pi lambda of sigma acting on z comma w, where z and w are complex. But then these are no longer unitary. So unless the range of f at lambda is contained in the domain of pi lambda of these, this integral does not make sense. So I have to assume that range of f at lambda. F at lambda is sort of has enough some smoothing properties so that the range is contained in the domain of these operators. These are unbounded operators. And I want that still to be Hilbert-Schmidt. Take the Hilbert-Schmidt norm squared and then integrate over un. I mean, this is integrating over un is for convenience, but all you need is sir, uniformly bounded. So that is the condition I want to assume on the Fourier transform side. So assume that. So once you assume that, you can consider that is the analog of this result. And the Euclidean case, take the Fourier transform. This is Euclidean.
Pi lambda sigma z, go back to the previous slide. Yes, sir.
No. How do I go back? Yeah. Maybe other. Now, today, if you don't insist on asking too many questions, I will be happy because I have to finish it before 5. I have another meeting to go. So what is your question now?
Okay, so pi lambda sigma z comma w.
Yeah.
What is this action you taking? And this pi lambda is a representation of pi lambda z sigma.
Yeah, I haven't defined. So there is a natural way of, so this will be coming in my course. So you wait for 2 more weeks, then you will see these things. I'm not defining all these things. So there is a natural way of defining these operators, and these are going to be unbounded operators. So this unbounded operator times f at lambda, I have to assume that this is Hilbert-Schmidt, and Hilbert-Schmidt's norm squared is integrable over the un. So this is the condition I have to impose on f at lambda.
So pi lambda z comma t, this pi lambda is a representation of Heisenberg group.
I'm putting t equal to 0. That is a notation. Pi lambda x comma u is nothing but pi lambda x comma 0. That is a notation. So CNC,
okay.
Yeah, the notation you have, it's not new to you. So this is the Euclidean analog of, whatever I have stated is the analog of this condition. So usually we just f at xi exponential 2 sigma y dot xi, anyway there is, this is not at all a condition, because in Euclidean case, if f is a nice function, this Fourier transform is going to be a bounded function, and then this modulus this into this, I want this to be a integrable, uniformly bounded in sigma, right, that's all. So it's not at all a condition. But then once you integrate, then you can bring in the Bessel function, and then you can see the analogy between this and the other condition. So I just brought it because of that. So now I'm not going to state this, what is this Gutsmuss formula for special limit expansions. So I only want to recall, this is a condition I'm assuming So this condition will come again and again. So assume this condition, and then there is something called Gutsmuss formula, and then you use that, then one can show that the condition, the previous condition, actually allows me to extend f lambda of x comma u holomorphically. So that is the reason. So that is sort of analog to this condition and the Heisenberg group case. So once we have the holomorphic extendability, so if we just look at this condition, forget about y, just put y equal to 0, v equal to 0, and this is inversion formula. So by the inversion formula, I will get this f lambda of x comma u. So now this simply, we know that this can be holomorphically extended. So this makes sense even with the x plus iy, u plus iv here. And once, so because of that, this has a holomorphic extension. And then now I look for a radial function f lambda, but that radial function should dominate this guy. So modulus of this has to be less than or equal to this e power half lambda, the symplectic form times f lambda y comma v. I want this, that is like the w of f hat of y. So this is going to play the role of w of f hat y in the Euclidean case. These operators, pi lambda of iy comma iv, these are going to be self-adjoint operators, unbounded. And then we have this relation, pi lambda of iy iv times pi lambda x comma u, that gives me this pi lambda x plus iy, y plus iv exponential thing. That is why this factor is coming. So a candidate for f lambda y comma v, so I need some function here. I'm looking for some radial function. So one candidate is given by this one. You take the supnorm of sup over all y prime v prime in modulus less than or equal to modulus of y comma v pi lambda I y prime v prime times f at lambda, take the trace norm and take the sup. So this is going to be an increasing function of modulus of this y comma v, and this is going to be a candidate for this f lambda y comma v. And this is going to play the role of whatever I have defined there, fw1 f hat y is sup mod y less than or equal to mod y, mod u less than or equal to mod y, integral exponential f hat of xi modulus exponential minus u x dot y, x dot u, right? So that is analog. So the version of the Bolling's theorem, little bit the modified version, I will get I will get an analog of that modified version for the Heisenberg group. So how do I do that? So I will just state the theorem first. So assume that the range of f at lambda is contained in a domain of pi lambda. Just check the time. Where is the time? Assume that this is the domain of pi lambda z comma w, and this pi lambda z comma w f at lambda is of trace class for all complex, such that the assumption that holds. So that I can talk about the holomorphic extendability, and since this condition will make sense only under those assumptions, then the following condition cannot hold for all lambda unless f equal to zero. So if I assume that for every lambda, this double integral is finite, integral of f hat lambda y comma v times this, if this is finite for every lambda, then f has to be zero. So this is the only trivial function. So this is the analog. So in formulation, I have assumed some extra condition on the Fourier transform side, and this plays the role of that W1 f hat y. So if I, using Gutsmuss formula, if I can show that this is holomorphic, then this is the starting point of the Hedderman proof. So I have this function, this is holomorphic, but then I need to assume, I have to make sure that this one is this integral converges, right? So for that, I make use of the inversion formula for the Weyl transform. This I already stated. And then let me take zeta equal to r plus is, because zeta is going to be one complex variable. And then look at f lambda zeta y zeta v. So I'm just changing zeta into real plus ir. And then you split this because it's a representation, projective representation. Then this R part is here and S is here and this is unitary. So I can forget it in taking the trace, and then this is self-adjoint. The above gives the estimate f lambda zeta y zeta v and this is the trace of this, and this is unitary, neglect it, and then this is self-adjoint. So trace norm of this, the product. So that is, this is one norm. So this guy is less than or equal to pi lambda is y comma v f at lambda 1. So now by considering the radial measurement of the right hand side for mod is less than or equal to 1, we see that this Fourier transform evaluated at zeta y, zeta v, this is dominated by this one. So this is coming because of our requirement that I need some estimate on this f lambda, zeta y, zeta v in terms of something involving the Fourier transform. That should be the analog of the Euclidean weight function W1, which we have defined. And this gives me the right analog. So this is the formulation. But once you have this, once you formulate it correctly, then I think everything goes through. So what happens? So you're assuming that this condition, assuming the condition on the Fourier transform, assuming whatever I have stated in the theorem, the double integral defining this capital F lambda converges. So that defines a holomorphic function in the strip, open strip, continuous up to the boundary, and then just continue with the proof. When R is real, just look at this. So again, use inversion formula and then make a change of variable, and you will get this. F lambda R will be R prime minus 2n F lambda of R inverse. And from this point onwards, you just repeat. Instead of just 1 plus zeta squared power n by 2, maybe you just will get just n or something, because the dimension is more. That's all. So you can repeat the proof. Whatever proof we have presented, the Hadamard's proof can be presented, and then the theorem is proved. So there is nothing except for the formulation, there is nothing in this theorem. So the crux of the matter is to showing that this hypothesis, which I have assumed on the Fourier transform side, and this is playing the role of the exponential function. I mean, this is natural. In defining the Fourier transform, exponential function is replaced by these unitary operators. But then in the Bolling condition, the exponential factor is, instead of taking e power I y dot psi, I have to take e power y dot psi, and I have to take the supremum over u module less than or equal to module, right? So that otherwise you have to take exponential modulus of y dot psi. And that is the analog. So I complexify it, and then f at lambda times that has to be a Hilbert-Schmidt operator, and that has to be integral. So this is the natural analog of whatever condition is there in the Euclidean setting. So I have to show that this, the crux of the matter is to show that this condition implies this is holomorphic function, holomorphic extendability of this function. But I think we will not address this question right now. So that is, as I said, that is the crux of the matter, and that's a long proof. Then I have to recall a whole lot of things. Even setting up the notation, etc., will take a long time. So I will not get into this. Let me just check my time. Okay. We have enough time. So an examination of the proof shows that we can also replace this W lambda. What is this W lambda? What was this W lambda? I forgot. Yeah, maybe this guy, I call it W lambda. Okay. I don't remember the notation. Yeah, so whatever we have, that this guy can be replaced by any radial increasing function, any other function f lambda satisfying the condition, whatever condition we have. So the only requirement is that this as a function of modulus of y comma v should be increasing. Then the conclusion of the theorem holds under this assumption, this f lambda thing. So there we have taken the supremum mod u comma v less than or equal to something, that condition. So that here I can replace. I need this some flexibility, because the interesting feature about this Bolling's theorem is that other uncertainty principles like Hardy's theorem, Kolling-Price theorem, etc., can be deduced from Bolling's theorem. The Euclidean setup, again, that is very easy to see that. But in the Heisenberg setup, if you want to deduce, I need this flexibility, because I may not be using the whatever weight function I used in the formulation of the Bolling's theorem in order to deduce these theorems. So I'm working towards that now. So uncertainty principles on Rn, yeah, these are just whatever I said. Colling price, Gelfand-Shillow, Hardy, everything can be deduced from Bolling's theorem. Maybe again, I'm going to rephrase it so that it is convenient to formulate analogs of such things on the Heisenberg group. So this is the Hardy's theorem. So this is the heat kernel for the Laplacian. Assume that F is decaying like the heat kernel and Fourier transform is decaying like the heat kernel. So the heat kernel at time A and this is heat kernel at time B. So suppose these two conditions are satisfied, then Hardy's theorem says that if A is less than B, then it has to be zero. Or more explicitly, modulus f of x is less than or equal to e power minus 1 over 4 mod x squared, and Fourier transform is decaying like e power minus b mod psi squared. That is your Fourier transform, this QB. And then under these conditions, A less than B implies f equal to 0. That is the theorem. And once we have this condition on the Fourier transform side, use the inversion formula. You estimate mod f of x plus iy. Just use this estimate. Then you see that it is simply QB. So this QB is a Gaussian function, so it can be holomorphically extended and evaluate it at iy. Then you get it's an exponential function increasing. So you'll get exponential 1 over b mod y squared. So this has a growth. It's a function of y. The growth is like this. And that is nothing but QB of iy. So if I assume that a is less than b, the modified Bolling's condition is satisfied if I take this weight function to be QB iy. And then we obtain the Hardy's theorem. So this is a Hardy's theorem. So assume that f of x equal to g into qa, f hat of psi equal to this into this. When g and h are coming from L infinity, then we had Hardy's theorem. And now assume that g and h are L2, not L infinity. Then that's what we get. That's how we get the Colling price theorem. And under this condition, I can rewrite f as phi convolved with this qb, and where phi hat equal to h, because I just take this. Hence, f belongs to the weighted Bergmann space. I have to say something about. Okay, this is the definition. Weighted Bergmann space BB CN is all entire functions which are square integrable on CN with respect to the weight function q 2b 2y. So that's all you have to say. And then the reproducing kernel for this Hilbert space is given by this Q2B Z minus W bar. And then this is a general nonsense. L2 norm of this will be less than or equal to the reproducing kernel along the diagonal. And that is nothing but Q2B at 2iy. And that is nothing but QBiy whole squared in the Euclidean case. So as in the case of Hardy's theorem, I can take again W of F at y equal to QB of iy. And that proves the Colling price theorem. So in both Hardy's theorem and Colling price theorem, the weight function is this, QB of iy. So f of y times QB of modulus f of y, modulus f hat of psi, and then, modulus f of y times QB iy is less than infinity. That will guarantee, because of Bolling's theorem, that f has to be equal to zero. That the finiteness condition will follow if you assume that a is less than b under that condition. So how do I get analogs of Hardy and Colling price theorem for the more general weighted Bergmann spaces? It is possible, but I have to assume at some conditions. Assume that we have a weighted Bergmann space, which is translation invariant. So that will force the weight function to be only a function of y, and then the reproducing kernel will look like this. And then we also assume, in both Colling price and Hardy, we are considering the weighted Bergmann spaces which occur as the image of L2 under some transformation given by a convolution kernel. So assume that there is a kernel Q such that F cross Q, this can be holomorphically extended, and there is some isometry property. L2 norm of F is the same thing as L2 norm of the holomorphically extended function with respect to some weight function. Assume this. There are several examples. Take any such weighted Bergmann space. And then in this case, the reproducing kernel is given by Q star Q. along z minus w bar, and this theorem can be. So this generalizes Hardy, Kolling price, everything, both. So assume that Q is a nice function such that the image of L2Rn under this transformation is a weighted Bergman space where W is radial. Under all these conditions, this is a version of Bergling. There is no non-trivial F in L2 for which this is true. F modulus F star Q at Y. This cannot be integrable with respect to this weight. Square root of Q star Q 2i y dy less than infinity. So this is sort of a Bolling's theorem. This covers both Hardy and Kolling price. So naturally, I want to prove such a theorem for the Fourier transform of the Heisenberg group. If I can do that, then I can deduce Hardy and Kolling price. So again, that is it's not difficult. All you have to do is consider the Siegel-Bergman transform associated to the Heisenberg group. So here, this is the Siegel-Bergman transform associated to the Laplacian on Rn. So this is also because QB is the heat kernel. So sometimes it's called the heat kernel transform. So now for the Heisenberg group, I have to look at the convolution with the heat kernel on the Heisenberg group associated to the sub-Laplacian. But again, going to the Fourier transform in the last variable, I can reduce matters to the so-called Twister-Bergman space case. So what is the Twister-Bergman case? Now these are spaces on C to N, entire functions, which are square integrable with respect to this weight. So W lambda is going to be a positive weight, but then the function has to be square integrable with respect to this into this exponential lambda times the symplectic form. So that is extra twist. These are called the Twister-Bergman spaces. And again, there are several Twister-Bergman spaces which are images of L2 R2n under some twisted convolution with a nice kernel. So one such thing is the when I take this Q lambda to be the heat kernel associated to the so-called twister Laplacian on C. So I assume this isometry property for a twisted Bergman space. And then in that case, again, the reproducing kernel will look like this. Q lambda, so this is again a twisted convolution with itself, evaluate along z minus z prime bar, w minus w prime bar, and then you put this twist, and then we can have this theorem. This is theorem. If Q is in L1 such that for every lambda, the image of L2 of R2n under the transform, this is a transform, twisted convolution with Q lambda. This is a twisted Bergman space where W lambda is radial. So the interesting case is when this Q is the heat kernel associated to the sub-Laplacian on the Heisenberg group, then this Q lambda will be the heat kernel associated to the twisted Laplacian. So these are explicitly known, and this has been well studied. And then the theorem says that there is no non-trivial F in L2Rn for which this integral is finite. So F lambda star lambda Q lambda, this cannot be integrable with respect to the square root of this reproducing kernel evaluated along 2iy, 2ib. So this is the theorem, analog of what I have stated just before the previous slide. And from this, we can deduce both Hardy and Kolling price. How do I do that? So as I said, I have to consider the Siegel-Bergman transform associated with the heat kernel for the sub-Laplacian. So yeah, here is the definition. Anyway, it doesn't serve any purpose. So sub-Laplacian is sum of squares of certain vector fields. So the Heisenberg group has dimension 2n plus 1. Lie algebra will have 2n plus 1 dimensions. There is one dimensional center that gives me this d by dt, the last variable, but then just forget about this and take the sum of squares of the remaining 2n vector fields, that is the sub-Laplacian, it's not Laplacian. So this is not elliptic, but still it generates a nice semigroup, and the kernel is sort of explicit, more or less. PS, x, comma, u, comma, xi, this is not explicit, but take the Fourier transform in the last variable. Then you have this PB lambda. So this is explicit, just like the heat kernel. Instead of 1 over T, I have this 1 over B. Instead of 1 over B, I have cot H B. And that's the change. That's the difference. and this is the heat kernel. And then the associated Twister-Bergmann spaces, they are given by this weight function. This is very similar to the Euclidean setting. The weight function is P to B to Y to B. Of course, there is a twist. So these are the Twister-Bergmann spaces. And then, so the reproducing kernel is again just given by this one, P to B lambda, 2IV, 2IY, 2IV. So as a consequence, this theorem I stated take the following form. So integral of F lambda star lambda, PB lambda, YV times square root of 2P to B lambda, 2IY, 2IV, dV, dy less than infinity. That is the hypothesis. And this implies F equal to zero. So that is the theorem. And once we have this, then we can deduce Hardy's theorem and Cowling price. But I haven't recalled what is Hardy's theorem for the Heisenberg group. So I have to do that. What is Hardy's theorem? So in the case of the Heisenberg group, again, the Fourier transform is operator valued. So if I take the Fourier transform of the heat kernel, I will get an operator, bounded operator, family of bounded operators, indexed by lambda. And that is nothing but e power minus b h lambda. And where h lambda is the Hermite operator, minus Laplace and plus lambda squared mod x squared. So this is the semigroup. So this is the kernel of the semigroup generated by the sublaplacian. You take the Fourier transform, you get the Hermite semigroup. So you want to measure a function, the decay of a function in terms of the heat kernel, say PA. But the measure, if you want to measure the decay of the Fourier transform, you have to use the Fourier transform of the heat kernel, which is given by this semigroup. So we have to do that. So this is the analog of Hardy's theorem. So this theorem is known. Assume that F decays like the heat kernel, you can put a constant here, decays like the heat kernel at time A, and the Fourier transform is a bounded linear operator. So I have to compare it with this semigroup. All I do is take the F at lambda star, F at lambda, make it a non-negative operator. And that non-negative operator, I compare with this non-negative operator. Otherwise, C times e power minus 2b h lambda minus this operator, that has to be positive. So that is the condition. That is the second condition on the Fourier transform. Function side is just F is straightforward. F is dominated by the heat kernel. Fourier transform side, Fourier transform is dominated by the Fourier transform of the heat kernel. And this is, in this sense, I take the comparison. The one is dominating the other. Then F is zero whenever A is less than B. So this is Hardy's theorem for the Fourier transform of the Heisenberg group. So how do I deduce this from Bolling's theorem? Something missing? No. Yeah, again, ideally, I should be able to replace the original previous condition by this condition, but then it's not possible. I mean, it is possible, but the Bolling's, I cannot deduce the result using from Bolling's theorem. So I just, in this situation, it's difficult to verify Bolling's condition, but then the original version, the Hardy condition I'm rewriting in this form. Taking the Fourier transform will be G lambda into PA lambda, and then PB lambda will be this PB into some family of bounded linear operators. Cowling price theorem happens to be the following. So here in the Hardy's theorem, this is a bounded function. And the Hardy's theorem, this is a bounded linear operator. But the Cowling price theorem, I have to assume that this B lambda is a family of Hilbert-Schmidt operators. But then I have some flexibility here. Instead of assuming that this is a bounded function, it's enough to assume that it is an L2 function. So this is Cowling price. Again, the Cowling price is also known for the Fourier transform. I'm just trying to deduce these two results from the Bolling's theorem, which I have stated. It can be deduced now. So this is the connection between, so now whatever theorem I have proved for the Heisenberg group, so from that I can deduce Hardy and Cowling price, not completely all the versions, but the major versions can be deduced. So the same ideas also lead to some interesting results for the Hermite expansions. So let me just state, I have just two slides. So take an L2 function and let PK be the PKF be the orthogonal projection of F onto the kth eigenspace of the Hermite operator with eigenvalue 2k plus n. So the eigenvalues of this, the spectrum of this operator is simply 2k plus n as k is a non-negative, positive, non-negative integer. And the eigenspaces are finite dimensional. These are the orthogonal projections. And this is the expansion. This is a spectral decomposition. And this is the Plancherel theorem. F can be expanded like this. And these are orthogonal to each other. And take the L2 norm squared, then get sum of squares of the L2 norm squares of the projections. So this is the Plancherel. Yeah. So what is, what happened to this? So is there any analog of, so there are analogs of Hardy's theorem for the Hermite expansion. That is, so function side you measure in terms of say Gaussian decay, and the Hermite coefficients you assume that they decay like the Hermite coefficients of the semigroup. So that means the Hermite coefficients should decay like e power minus something like 2 mod alpha plus n times t or b. So there is a Hardy's theorem, but then is it possible to formulate a Bolling's theorem and then so that I can deduce Hardy and Kolding price, etc., from Bolling's theorem. So here is the version. So again, this is a function on Rn, but then on the Fourier transform side, so there is no Fourier transform here, but the spectral projections, they play the Fourier transform, the role of the Fourier transform. So PKF. So PKF, L2 norm. So K is the parameter. So how much? So this can be allowed to grow, but then I want the function F times this. They should be summable or integrable with respect to some weight function in both variables, k and y. K and y are the variables. So I need something which is depending on both k and y. So and that is given by this guy, square root of phi k n minus 1 to y. It's a function of y, it's a function of k. And if this guy f of y times pk of L2 norm is summable or integrable with respect to this measure, times the counting measure over this. Otherwise, sum of these integrals of this with respect to y should be finite. Then f is zero. That is the Bolling's theorem. And why is this coming? And again, this is the natural analog of the exponential. So here, Lk n minus 1 t is the Legger polynomial. And this is a polynomial. I can take it to be complex. So in particular, this is defined for negative values of t also. Take Lk n minus 1 at minus 2 mod y squared exponential mod y squared. So this is increasing as a function of y. And that's what I denote by phi k n minus 1 to y. And that is what I have used. And this plays a role of this exponential thing. And anyway, this has played an important role in several situations where I have to find analogs of this guy. And this is the right analog. And that can be seen from Kurzmus formula for Hermite expansions and Kurzmus formula for special Hermite expansions, Hit kernel transform associated to Hermite or special Hermite operator. So this is the analog of this exponential. So with that, as an immediate corollary, we get Hardy's theorem. This is Hardy's theorem. FDK is like e to the power minus half a mod x squared, and then the projections decay like e to the power minus half b to k plus n. Then this guy has to be zero whenever a times tan h b has to be is bigger than 1. So this is Hardy Hermite that can be deduced from. Anyway, this is also well known. I'm just giving a different proof using Bolling's theorem. And I'm sorry about this. I should have said Dhanyavadagalu or Dhanyavad or maybe something else. Kritagnyata, Nandri, Nanni, all those things. And this shows that I forgot to erase this because this was the same talk I gave in Bilbao. So Basque country. So this is Basque and this is Spanish. Sorry about that. There is no thanks.
Okay, thank you very much for the nice talk. So do you have any questions or comments? Yeah. So Munna, yeah.
I will take questions from Munna.
No, I will not ask for any question.
No, you cannot.
Sorry about that, but from anybody else?
I have a question. Yeah.
Yes.
You gave that Bohrling's theorem in the beginning and a simple proof, no?
Yeah.
But that seems to have more condition like integrability and such thing. Is that true? No. That is what I felt.
No, the integrability condition is, I mean, original integrability condition is integral over Rn cross Rn. That I just translated into one integrability.
Whatever condition theorem states, then yeah. With under that condition, that proof goes through, is it? That simple proof?
Yeah, simple proof, yeah. That simple proof goes. I mean, the crux of the matter is that there is this weight function dominating F evaluated in the complex chain. And that weight function, I mean, F should be integrable with respect to that weight function. This two implies that is the crux of. So there is some flexibility.
Okay.
So for the Heisenberg group, I needed that flexibility. So I mean, so I was groping in the darkness for quite some time to find the right analog of that condition. But then once I see there is some flexibility, then one can use.
Okay. So Rajesh, you can unmute.
Yeah. I think a question similar to Ratnakumar, but since I missed part of the talk, so I wanted to bother Thangavelu again, meaning this thing, so the Bohrling, what was that? How do you call it? The Bohrling?
Bohrling's uncertainty principle or Bohrling's theorem?
Yeah. So is it stronger than the Hardy thing? I missed the thing. So how, meaning, is it
a new? That's what I proved. Stronger than Hardy, Price, Gelfand-Shelov, I didn't touch, but Kowling Price and Hardy, it is stronger. And actually, I don't have the analog of Bonomi, Demange, Chamin theorem. That is little bit more general than the original Bohrling's theorem. That version I haven't proved. I mean, I didn't try.
Mm-hmm.
So because of that, all Kowling Price.
And does there have, do you have things like analogous things on bounded domains? Can you do?
No, then you have to formulate two things. This is about the decay of function on the spectral side. So you just go in generality and automation. How do you measure the decay?
Yeah.
And Hardy's theorem, etc.
Sure.
Probably
we know this Bohrling theorem for nilpotent groups.
Yeah. So, but those theorems are mainly taking to the operator norm and considering as a function of lambda.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is a different kind. But the Heisenberg group, for example, that theorem. That kind of version will be trivial for the Heisenberg group.
I do not know about other versions, but at least Bohrling's theorem for connected and simply connected nilpotent groups.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. All those things you want to do, just to kill. The Fourier transform side will measure the decay in terms of the Hilbert-Schmidt operator now.
Yeah.
That decay is measured in terms of the parameter involved in the transmission. That has a different nature. So when I do such things, it is almost.
Okay, Jyotsurup, you can. Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, I wanted to know that are there Bohrling theorems known for, like here you are integrating over the whole space.
Yeah.
If you have a conical region, so instead of the whole.
No, I don't know. I haven't followed this for some time, but suddenly looking at Hermann's proof, I thought I can do something.
Okay,
No, yeah, just ask your question first.
Another question is that so the condition for Heisenberg group, you are having condition for each lambda, right?
Yeah.
So can one somehow, instead of each lambda, can it be sort of weakened?
No, then if you assume some holomorphicity in the lambda variable, then we don't have to assume this. So then it's enough to assume. So if you put some decay in the lambda variable, then the function in the t variable, it will be holomorphic. And then, the other way. In the, you want to put some decay in the t variable so that as a function of lambda, it will be holomorphic. Then this condition is enough to assume this condition over an open set or something. Then I can, that way we can weaken it.
Okay.
No, actually, okay. I didn't explore all such possibilities. So.
Yes, so Shogato, sir. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir. This joint decay of x and y in terms of exponential, have you thought of any analog of this on symmetric spaces?
The symmetric space, this proof will not work because we use the dilation.
Right.
Yeah, this won't work. So, but there should be some other way of doing it. I don't know how to do that. Now, that is a good question for symmetric spaces. This Hadamard's proof will not work.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, so Rajesh, you have any other question?
More like a comment. So I was interested in how long you've been thinking about this and how long did it take for you to look at the right analog for the exponentials kind of this thing.
This is something which I wanted to do it, but I gave up. I mean, gave up means I didn't try hard, but maybe during this pandemic, probably. Suddenly I thought I will try to do something. So it took. So maybe, I don't know, 2-3 weeks. No, I think I really have to.
Okay, let's unmute and let's thank the speaker again. Yes.
I'm sorry about this.
Yes,
maybe we can. I'm leaving. Bye.